Come on, man. And with the local DBC news, Echo Jane will join us in the comeback. But tonight, don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years, I'm rocking my peers, foot soft and beer, making the tears rain down like a monsoon. Listen to the bass go boom, explosion. Overpowering, over the competition, I'm towering, wrecking shots. When I drop these lyrics that'll make you call the cops, don't you dare stare, you better move. Don't ever compare, beat to the rest that'll all get sliced and diced. Competition's paying the price.
Good evening, Word Wrestling fans. This is Page Match. Please welcome to the stage your host for tonight's events, the Rhymestone Cowboy! Some head ripping, blood curdling, lip splitting, knockout prose. Are you ready to see the best spoken word artist in the universe do battle head to head? Winner takes all. I suppose you want to know who's on the list. Do you want to know who's on the list? We have, and give a cheer for your favourites, give a cheer for your favourites. We have Adam, lick off your head top with a car size Leng, Kammerling. We have Natasha T, the killer, Miller. We have Rob, Macho Man, Robbie Savage in the sky, the first, Auton. We have Inua, Babatunde Banna, aka the incredible Nigerian Hulk, Ellams. We have Emma, Crush Your Bones Jones. We have Hollie, Megatron McNish. We have Peter, the Penge player, Hayhoe. We have Laurie, the Queen of Shots, Bolger. We have Mixy, the Rabbit Killer. Mark, the educationalist Grist. The champagne conceptualist, aka Ross, the Cumberband Sutherland. And of course, all the way from my home county, we have Luke, the Earl of Essex, Wright. So are you ready? This guy here is ready. Are you ready over here? Are you ready over here? Are you ready over here? I think we're ready. The time has come. Let's get ready to rumble! please welcome to the stage the king of slams, Adam. Lick off your head top with a car size Leng Kammerling. Give it up. And tonight's opponent, trying to take Adam's title away. Please welcome to the stage, all the way from the US of A, Natasha T, the Killer Miller! First battle of the night, King of Slams, seconds out, and fight.
This is not a poem. It is a bowl of cereal. Breakfast cereal, the finest breakfast cereal known to the residents of Stamford Hill, plucked from the shelves of Morrison's like an artichoke from its stalk. The finest breakfast cereal. This is not a poem. It is a bowl of breakfast cereal, the finest bowl of Kellogg's crunchy nut clusters with chocolate curls. Raise your fists, cluster buddies. Raise your fist, cluster buddies in Stamford Hill, Finsbury Park, Arsenal, and the world! Naysayers be darned, your Jordan country crisps and Dorset mueslis languish in pools of eye crust and dog turds, a potent, ordinary boredom like brown snake venom smeared on a fixed fine notice for public urination. Crunchy nut clusters with chocolate curls are the puppeteers of the puppeteers of the puppeteers of humans. To them, Mount Olympus is a ketamine stove under a sofa bed in a crack squat in Archway. They are golden nuggets of toasted love. This is not a poem. It is a bowl of crunchy nut clusters with chocolate curls. And every day I wake and eat a big old bowl of this perfect breakfast, and I feel my body bolstered, strengthened from the inside out. And I know it is the greatest breakfast I or anyone could ever consume, and every day I consume it, and I know I am great, and that everything I produce by proxy is great. But hang on, just one moment. What if today I want toast or poached eggs or curry for breakfast? What if I have no milk? What if I plan to go back to bed and do not want to deal with the sugar high? What if I have taken drugs? Not that I would ever take drugs. And my mouth is cut up and the jagged chunks of crunchy nut are stabbing my chewed up cheeks, stabbing my ulcered gums. What if I just want something different? I can't, because I am afraid. Not everyone likes curry. What if my poems become like curry? What if my poems become like poached eggs? Not everyone likes poached eggs or curry. I might not win slams with poached eggs or curry. I might not win slams with poached eggs or curry. I might not win slams. And that is why I don't eat poached eggs or curry for breakfast. And that is why this poem is a bowl of Kellogg's Crunchy Nut Clusters with chocolate curls. And an English breakfast is a palette of flavors designed to be smudged, and no two are ever exactly the same. And I want to eat curry for breakfast. And if there's leftovers, I will. And as much as I love Kellogg's Crunchy Nut Clusters with chocolate curls, it doesn't half get sickly after a couple of bowls.
Between a British poet and an American poet. A British poet will give you butterflies. An American poet will give you eagles with wings strong enough to cause a hurricane in your lungs every time you take a breath in their presence. A British poet will make you smile. An American poet would make your tongue feel like a seven-year-old little girl and your lips split like the ropes that are about to help her double dutch her way into popularity. A British poet will come over to your house and help clean up your kitchen. An American poet will come into your life and help clean up your credit. A British poet will take off all of their clothes and ask you to do some shit like have sex with them or make love to them. But an American poet will take off all of their insecurities, leave their pride on your pillows, and ask you to have your way with them, or make God reconsider his policy on things like racism and sexism and poverty, because an American poet knows that that is making love. A British poet will compliment your outfit. An American poet will compliment your whole existence. See, you trip over British poets. You untie your shoelaces, dig a hole in the concrete, blindfold yourself, run forward and fall stone. For American poets, you introduce British poets like, hey mom, meet this poet. You introduce American poets like, this is the reason I've been sleeping lately. This is the reason my heartbeat can make a set of drums sound like the violin. They're the career that made me realize all of my old poets were just jobs and I had to work harder. If I wanted to retire blissfully, an American poet, she makes you taller. She's something like a spine. A British poet ain't shit more than a sling or a back brace, and I need a lot more. I need a lot more than a care package after an earthquake. See, nowadays, most of us are too willing to sign for packages a lot lighter than we ordered. Now, I'm not saying that you can't turn a British poet into an American poet. I'm just saying that shit is like trying to turn Miley Cyrus into the Queen. A PC into an Apple, and I've been dressing myself long enough to know what looks good on me. And I'm sorry, but a British poet is a genre that I passed down to my little cousins years ago. Thank you.
So here we are. It's up to you guys who won this battle. So over in the red corner there, we have Adam Kammerling. If you think Adam Kammerling should take his belt home today with him, please give it up! But if you think all the way from the US of A, putting us British poets down. If you think Natasha T, the killer Miller, should take home, you won't get this through customs anyway. But if you think Natasha T. Miller should take this home, make some noise. The winner of the first bout is Natasha T. Miller! That was the first battle. It's time for the second battle. This is the Light Heavy Word Championship. And introducing to the stage, we have Inua Babatunde Bana, a.k.a. the incredible Nigerian Hulk Ellams. Give it up! Rob, Macho Man, Robbie Savage, In the Sky, the First, Auton! You right there, Rob? You okay? Okay, you might have noticed, there's not a belt for this. There's something much more important to be won here. There's something much more important. It's bigger than life and death. The loser will have, in this case, In Heaven, The Onions Make You Laugh by Rob Auton. If Rob was to lose, he will have his book shredded. Now, I went on Amazon to buy Inua's book, and because he's so popular, it was sold out. But I have my suspicions, Inua, that he already bought them up before I could get there. So in which case, we haven't got a book to shred, so what we are going to do is... Yeah. It's almost as bad as that. We are going to shred lots of copies of Inua's face. So please bring on the shredder! I'm not sure that just happened. But anyway, we're ready for our next bout. Seconds out. And fight.
Hey, could you get out of the ring, Inua? Thanks. I really like the sky. So I write stuff about the sky. I don't write stuff about Inua. I've written stuff about the sky. Does everyone like the sky? Yeah. All right. Well, I really like the sky. I'll tell you someone who doesn't like the sky. Inua. He's a sky molester. It's more views than news. I'd just like to tell you, that's not a real camera. It's hollow. Right. There's page 3. I left the rising for all the perverts. There's choosing like a rectangular burqa, made entirely from sky. She's in disguise. Disguise. Right. I guess this is kind of my battle piece, right? But it's actually about a sunset, so we'll see how it goes. It's coming up. Who likes Christmas? Do you like Christmas? Yeah. I don't know which way to face. Where are you? What's your name?
My name's Grace.
All right, Grace. On Christmas, I received a Lego sunset. On the box was a printed photograph. A sunset from a far-off land, or it could have been England. The set was made up from red, orange, yellow, and pink bricks. It contained two small figures, a couple. The couple were not made with regular Lego hands. They had hands that could hold each other. As I began to build the set in the front room, was that you, Grace? No, not a fan of the Lego hands line, Grace, all right. The light in the as I began to build a set in the front room with the early morning curtains closed, the light in the room began to change. New shadows appeared. In the box was a pair of children's sunglasses and a small bottle of Factor 15 sun cream. I put the sunglasses on, applied the sun cream to my now burning arms, and continued to build. Stepping back from my creation, the room was now full of unnatural light. The flowers on the mantelpiece lifted their heads in confusion. Body clocks broken. I fixed the couple's hands together. The man with the raised yellow circle on his square palm and the woman with the corresponding indented circle on hers. They stood about a meter from the sunset. It was finished. The pinks and reds were almost soft, fuzzy-edged Lego bricks. I lowered my head down to the carpet and looked at the faces of the couple, the setting of the sun, now reddening their yellowness. Smiles fixed in position forever, perfectly dressed in skin-tight clothes. There was no response. Dad! Come and look at this! I ran through into their bedroom. Wake up! Come and look at this sunset I've made. What? Oh yeah, the Lego. We went back through into the living room and all that remained were two long red bricks slowly sinking into the carpet. The couple were nowhere to be seen. But Dad, where's it gone? I want to play with my sunset. With this, my mum entered the room with another box. Rob, we forgot to give you this that Father Christmas dropped off you. We found it under our bed. I opened it. Another Lego set. The night sky. Bricks of blacks, blues, purples, and a small selection of whites. Remember, son, said my dad, your sunset doubles as a sunrise.
Didn't rule the skies that much. He could have stopped that happening. So, yeah, he thinks he can come down from the sky and like judge our newspapers of choice. Boo. Right, no. I live on Earth and I like walking. So this is about walking. You guys like walking? Likes walking. Yes, boo. Flying is bad for the environment. We have voted Green Party. Two people. This is why the Conservatives are part of your fault. Your fault. Right. So, this is about walking. It's called directions. You know the wild bush at the back of the flat? The one that scrapes the kitchen window, the one that struggles for soil and water and fails where the train tracks scar the ground. You know how if you leave the bush and walk the stunted land, you come to crossroads paved just weeks ago, hot tar over the flattened roots of trees, and a squad of traffic lights, red-eyed now, stiff against the filth-stained fallen leaves. And further on, you know the bruised allotments with the broken sheds? And if you go beyond that, you hit the first block of Thomas Street Estate. Well, if you enter and ascend, and you might need a running jump over dank puddles into the shaking lift that goes no further than the fourth floor, you'll eventually come some rough rise of stairs that reach without railings, the rundown roof, as high as you can go, and a good place to stop. The best time is late evening, when the moon fights through drifts of fumes as you're walking. When you find an upturned bin to sit on, you'll be able to see the smog pour across the city and blur the shapes and tones of things. And you'll be attacked by a symphony of tires, airplanes, sirens, screams, and engines. And if this is your day, you might even catch a car chase or hear a horde of biker boys thunder across the bridge. But it is tough to speak these things. How tufts of smog enter the body and begin to wind us down. How the city chokes us painfully against its chest, carved of secrets and fire. How we, built of weaker things, regard our sculpted landscapes, water flowing through pipes, the clicks of satellites passing over clouds, and the roofs where we stand in a shudder of progress, giving ourselves to the vast outsides. Still, text me before you set out. Knock when you reach my door, and I will walk you as far as the train tracks with water for your travels and a hug. I will watch after you and not turn back to the flat till you merge with the throngs of buses and cyclists heading down towards the block, scuffing the ground with your feet. Cheers.
So who's going to be the winner of this light heavy word championship match in the red corner? If you want Inua's face to survive and Rob's book to be shredded, please make some noise for Inua! And in the blue corner, if you want Rob's life's work to survive, but you want to see Inua's face shredded, give it up for Rob!
I'm sorry to do this to you, Rob, but you are going to have to shred Inua's face. You are the winner! Shred Inua's face. Do shred that face. There it goes. Keep it going. I mean, that's going to take all night. Pete, start the music, the loser's music. Let's hear it for the shredder as well. Okay, it's the third and final battle of this half. It's the Word Championship Tag Three Stage Hell Match. Bangs of the Gun versus the Dead Poets. So please welcome to the stage Mark, the Educationalist Grist, and Mixy, the Rabbit Killer, aka the Dead Poets! And their opponents. Please welcome to the stage Laurie, the Queen of Shops, and Peter, the Pens player. Hayhoe, aka Bang Said the Gun.
Host of Bang Said the Gun anymore, Dan Cockrill. You're a has-been Dan Cockrill. You're a nobody, Dan Cockrill. I'm Jack Rook, and I'm the host of Bang Said the Gun now, Dan Cockrill. Yeah? Ooh, we're at the Roundhouse. All arts. Oh, Primrose Hill, around the corner. No, Dan Cockrill. No. We're not here for you with your blue cardigan. We're not here for the Roundhouse. This room isn't even round. It's about as round as a shreddy. Yeah, we're not here for you two. Please bring on Team Bangside the Gun. Shut up. Shut up when I've got the mic. Shush.
I am Bang Said the Gun. Let's get on with it. Let's get this is the first round. It's a duet. It's a love or hate duet.
Our poets do more than just love and hate. Our poets will do anything you want. Get off the stage. Get off the stage.
Seconds out. Fight.
Wow. Wow. She's here on our pillow. Sunshine coating her hair, and it reminds me of cornfields. Or are they wheat fields? You know, the beautiful kind you normally see in a Superman movie.
To be honest, I can't stand him. I mean, what the fuck was I thinking?
I love her. I love to watch her when she wakes, her drowsy little eyes springing to life. I wonder if she was aware that I was watching her while she slept. I had that little sniff of her hair. It smelled really, really nice. Glazed, plug-in, nice. Scent of jasmine, nice.
Did I actually let him in? I don't know what I was thinking. I mean, it was the work party. I was off my face, mate, all over the place. We work in Asda on the deli. He breathes very heavily and smells like Scotch eggs. Oh, my head.
Last night, she was so funny. She said...
You're, like, really fucking irritating.
And I gently nudged her on the arm and she said...
No, you really do properly annoy me.
And I just smiled.
He's an Asda supervisor, right? But I have dreams. More than cold meat and cheese and fuck me, he's such a geek. He's totally obsessed with Avatar. And when we watched it, all he kept telling me was...
You know, this isn't in 3D. It's so much better in 3D.
And I felt like saying, yeah, I can bloody see it's not in 3D, mate, you dick.
She loves Avatar. And sometimes she puts this cute, stroppy face on in the morning and I just want to pinch those little cheeks. I mean, this just feels right. I mean, proper right. This is the kind of love that Michael Bolton would sing about.
I'm pretty sure that I did actually leave him on the couch.
But at the same time, our relationship isn't all about sex. It's more than just cheap fumbles. It's about really getting to know each other on a one-on-one basis.
God, well, it's hardly fucking Harry Met Sally, is it? It's more 10 things I hate about you, and he will not leave my house. And he's staring at me, and he smells like Scotch eggs, and I'm pretty much 100% sure that he has just smelt my hair.
And is it possible to love someone too much? Because my heart feels close to bursting. And no, sometimes it can be sort of annoying, but I think she might be the one.
Look, mate. Hi. So, I'm not really sure how you got in my house, and I find you fairly irritating and fairly clingy, and like I said, I don't remember letting you in my house, and I'm not really sure why you're in my dressing gown, but please, can you make sure that you just don't tell anyone at Asda, I mean, like, anyone, especially Jim on the bakery, for God's sake, and can I have my underwear back as well, please, thanks.
I knew. This would happen. I mean, she was always too good for me. I'm just a supervisor. Cold meat and cheese. And she's my avatar. The person that I wanna be. Dumb! Dumb, you guys! Try that for size, eh?
Thought that I was in love because she was only 10 years old. And I was as well. Make that a bit clear. But I was 10 years old, I really, really fancied her, this girl, and her name is quite an unusual name. She was called Beth Builder. When I was 10 years old, I knew that her name was alliterative, but that's not why she'd give me thrills running past the classroom windowsill. A short skirt, a shrill shriek, whenever she ran home from school. See, Beth Builder was gorgeous, in a way that you just couldn't score it. She was beauty in the way that Tony Hart would draw it, and the primary school rumour mill was green and in full grind because Beth Builder had said that she fancied me. She told Liz Windell behind the Cadbury's factory it was only a matter of time till she would maybe even talk to me. I blushed at her company for weeks, and as Liz recounted Beth's speech of fancy, I felt resplendent, my cheeks aflame. I was reeling during break time, thinking, Beth Builder feels the same, and when I went home that night to play my computer game, she was every princess I did rescue, I was every hero she did tame, but over the following days I began to grow dismayed. See, Beth didn't come and talk to me. She stayed with her mates. She played by the gates, and when I waved, she kind of laughed, causing my heart to deflate as my mates would push me over with this impending sense of dread. Her tender voice of glass cried out, "Piss off, cabbage heads!" See, because back then my hair was kind of crap. And unruly, and during primary school she did not want to know me because I had all these curls. And so that whirl of pride that Liz's eyes would unfold, it just kind of blew up inside. And I began to realise that love was a lot more complicated than I'm led to understand. If I was going to go out with Beth Builder, what I needed was a plan. So I came up with one, using my mum as a template for all women across the land. If I was going to impress Beth, I had to dress smart, be polite, and work really hard, like show the depth of knowledge I could command. But I was so absorbed in this plan that I didn't see or understand that Beth didn't really care about that English and maths work my mother thought was so grand. See, Beth Builder's main hobby was preserving dolls' dresses in little plastic bags. Well, I stuck around after class discussing chess and white dwarf max, and the fact that Miss Howe's face sagged whenever Beth ended in her work, it just didn't register. I wanted so badly to impress her, that's the stupor I was in, that I just worked like a demon. I read through the blue, green, red and purple section till I was the first kid who'd managed to read everything in my school, and I worked, and I worked, and I worked. Well, Beth just played, laughed, joked outside, doing handstands, showing other boys her frilly knickers, and all I was getting from efforts was a bunch of smiley stickers, and I thought, well, it's not good enough. 1 week after coming top in some tests, I thought it might be best to phone Beth Builder and ask her out, yeah. So I did, right? The receiver slipping in my palm. When Beth picked up, I said, hello, in a way that I hoped sounded calm. She said, who's that? I said, it's Mark. She said, oh, what cabbage head. Here I attempted a feeble laugh. She said, wait there, and left for what seemed like ages. Until another voice came on the phone, just this little gurgling whisper. And I realised that Beth had put me on the phone to a little baby sister. So I said, oh, hello. And just this pause, like this hesitation. And then finally just this babyish declaration of, and she taught her baby sister to say it, and I don't know what it was, but those words had a kind of scalpel effect on me. I yelped, I dropped the phone to Beth's laughter, ran, tripped on the directory. Apparently, it was the first time that baby had said two words consecutively. I didn't care, but I put in my heart, thinking all that there was, and she had ripped it apart. And I promised myself that I would forever walk the path that had no girls, no handstands, forever and ever and ever. But I got over it. Cool. Thank you very much.
Are we on here? Okay. I have a very little bit of love, because I'm so full of love, and I love you all so much. It's getting quite emotional, so if I cry... All right, I'll tell you, I'll just do the fucking poem instead. All right, it goes. Now there's a storm coming. Let's get a couple of pairs of handcuffs, find a tree, put our backs to it and detach our wrists. Let's embrace the power of nature, face the force that once created us, accept that we may be destroyed, and that's how it is. If those roots were to be torn from the ground and we rolled through the clouds, I would sing your favourite song as the wind allowed us to drift. And when it was finally our time to come down, I'd unlock just one cuff, so we'll always fly together to remind us why we exist.
Okay. That's round one. That's round one. Let's hear it for the Dead Poets, see if they're in the lead. Let's hear it for the Dead Poets. Let's hear it for the Bangs of the Gun, see if they're in the lead. Okay, I think round one definitely went to the Dead Poets there. Round one, they're in the lead. So, this is a solo round. Round two, Seconds out. Fight.
It's actually me.
Ladies first.
Actually yeah. Me, yeah, fucking hell. Fine, well, do what you want. Okay, cool. So, yeah. Can you hold this, Pete? Thanks, buddy. Cool. Where's my mic gone? Can you hear me? Can you?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Right, this is a poem called Drunk Dialing. It's for anyone that has ever drunk dialed someone. Has anyone ever done that? Of course you have. Nice, cool. Can you hear me all right? Okay, lovely, cool. So it goes like this. This is a Euston train via Hammersmith, but tonight I'd go anywhere as long as you're there because I'm drunk, okay? And you're a bit of all right. And I know that I deleted you from my phone, yeah, but tonight I'm drunk dialing you from the depths of my inbox. And I know that we've only been seeing each other for 1 week, okay? But I'm pretty sure that you are the love of my life, mate. And I'm Langers. Rotten, drunk, polluted, rat-ass, mullered, wrecked, and I want to have sex. And I should never have put you on speed dial, okay? Because phone sex on the doorstep of a chip shop is not sexy. Especially when you don't pick up. And if you were here, I'd tell you that this isn't sick on my dress. No, I just spilt curry sauce and ketchup down my dress. Yes, I did order everything with cheesy chips. And no cabbie would have me, and I know that I only live down the road, okay? But after six tequila slammers, some sambuca, and then cider, yeah, your place, it seems that much closer and much cosier. So I start walking and the pavement is a ship deck and I'm giving it one of those drunk wobble gesture to audience. Not doing it. And I'm sure it's fine if when calling you for the 16th time you refuse to pick up. Do you know what, mate? I'll just come over anyway. Because, let's face it, nice day niceties, they've gone out the window. And it's actually your voicemail that I'm talking to and not you. So I start ranting the following. Have you got another girl there? You never cared about us. It's your ex, isn't it? I can hear her breathing down the phone. I am a psycho. I am a psycho. Like, really, I am a psycho. I'm a psycho. And then I burp down the phone, but I've eaten half a box of Tic Tac, so it smells slightly like a mint. And not waiting for a reply after 2 minutes. Remember, the voicemail lady, great. Please press 1 to re-record your message. Or is it press 3? Fuck me now, I'm just pushing random buttons. So you probably got me saved for your enjoyment. Go on, listen to me over your cornflakes going, maybe we were just a mistake. Give up or hang up, one last attempt. Ignore what I just said. I'll be over in a sec because I have worn my good knickers, okay? And I just wanted to get laid, but why in the world would you leave your heavy slumber, your nice warm bed for this drunken mess? This is the sad bit. So I call it a day. I end up at mine. It's around midday and all I've managed to remove is just the one shoe. It's the sad bit. Got my hand in a petrol garage sandwich box and I've got my head on a packet of crisps and I've got a DVD of Titanic. Yep, and it's frozen on scene selection, playing over and 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 over like a dream. So technically I've woken up with Celine fucking Dion and not you at all. Oh, and that text from you, what did you want last night, babe? I was asleep. I go, look, mate, whatever you do, just do not check your voicemail.
Check. Oh, way. Hello. Yeah, if you could stop calling, that'd be great. Thanks. I mean, you're all right, you're lovely and everything, but, you know, you pretty much explained all the reasons I didn't pick my phone up. So, but thank you, because it's nice to feel loved. We all like that. Anyway, I'm going to read you a quick piece. See, I believe it's all about innovation over imitation. I itch with invitation, invite insight. My implication is I inspire individuals, it's irrigation, incubate ideas, intrigue with alliteration, but it's not about I, it's about you. Every letter before, between and after you might use, every word you construct, every sentence you include, every paragraph and page you put your pen to groove, every piece of paper placed upon a pile of what you're making, provides a peep of people's paranoia, lacking patience, passion pounding powerful when pacing down the pavements, and this beat holds no relevance, but it's all them manner chasing. See, I just make my statements, and I'm fortunate to just be at the stage that pays. I'm not flush, but it's enough, and maybe that's because I don't say the same stuff. I never move to fit the groove, I carve my own rut, sure. I get stuck, and there's less about to help me out, but like everyone does, I picked it up and held it down, sucked it in and let it out, set it straight, then spun it round. I compose alone, then go and throw it at another crowd, see whether it be spoken word or gunning down some battle man, rocking with a DJ, or jamming with a band, or recording in the studio. I'm happy where I am, you will never stop me writing. Even if I lack my hands, I will find a way to scribble more. See, I could never leave it. Though I've grown to know how cold and fickle this whole scene is, you see, I love what I do. There's no other reason needed. If you're lacking on that passion, you've got a lot to compete with. What you're saying, do you mean it? What you're chasing, do you need it? When it gets tough, will you be the one who moves on or retreats? How would you feel if you chase one dream all your life, then feel it slowly slipping through your fingers like you might not achieve it? Is that something you can deal with? Then welcome to the game. I will do all I can to help you, try support in any way. If I could ask you one favour, one promise you could make, is that you do you, don't copy or blend in with the same. See, I believe it's about skill over swagger, ability over attitude, and innovation over imitation.
Shut the fuck!
You're just not very nice.
At least I know how to use a mic, Mixy.
At least I know how to cut my hair, dickhead.
Okay. Unfortunately, because the Dead Poets didn't manage to finish that round, I'm going to hand that round to Banks at the Gun. So it's the final round, it's the decider. It's round three. Who's it gonna be? Seconds out.
This is going out to all my brothers that passed away. Woolworths, Blockbusters, Rumbelows. Let's take this battle to the streets. The high streets. My rhymes are hotter than a Greg steak bake. Like a Lidl's cashier, you made a mistake. Yo, yo, you underestimate, son. Got a neck to poets, but dead poets ain't one. Whoa!
He's got over 1,000 neck to poets.
Please, 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 please. Let me introduce you to Mr. Muscle and Mr. Sheen. Our rhymes are so fresh and so clean, clean. They're like a buy one, get one free on multi-packs of Listerine. Our boots are... Our rhymes are so sick, they belong in Boots Pharmacy. And yours, they belong in Aldi, guys, because you're properly cheap. I mean, Pound Stretcher wouldn't even let you guys in, Pete.
You need a store guide for these rhymes. I mean, we're like loads of shops. Loads of shops.
Westfields! Westfields! I'm coming at you with my shopping bags, lots. I'm coming at you with my price gun pop. They call me Mary Queen of Shops. I'm the lyrical Harrods. Silver tongue, golden bars. My words are like caviar. Diamonds for the stars. If I'm Chanel, then you're Primark. If I'm Jimmy Choo, then you're Barrett's. I'm like the changing rooms in Harvey Nicks. I wanna make you take your clothes off, Mark Grist.
Jokes!
You're Sainsbury's basic. Guys, you're Asda Price. You're why mums go to Iceland. And I'm gonna make you both melt. You're like a Tesco value ready meal. It's shit, but look, every little helps, yeah?
All right, Simile, so... your plans are all scuttled, like crabs out the sea. You're close to defeat, like an attack on the knees. We're gonna kick your asses out like Adam and Eve, cos you're weak and lack depth, like a crap cup of tea.
You're a couple of pricks. There's more, there's more. It's not the punchline, right? It's not the punchline. Like a double-edged needle. We're shitting all over you like an overfed seagull. We hold our own like a hairnet.
You've got no presence like a cabbage patch parent.
You'll get battered like a chip shop cod. You're disposable like a wooden fork. You're a bit like Boris Johnson. We wish you wouldn't talk.
Yeah. You're about as sweaty as a politician, about as threatening as a stroppy kitten. We'll win this fight. It's kind of like simple mathy long division.
There's no multis to you. You're just not a factor.
We bring venom to maths, a bit like an adder.
Your angles are weak, like a wonky protractor.
And you're failing this test, like Lance Armstrong's bladder. We're deep and unfathomable, a bit like the universe. We've no time for you two, like Bono was rude to us. Sorry.
And you two are full of shit like sewers. You're like erectile dysfunction, useless pricks. You're like successful dieters, the biggest losers. You need to know we're murking this like pubic wigs.
You need cutting, like you grow long hair.
You like the fact I've got exactly 74% battery on my phone?
No one cares.
See, we're tight and alluring.
Lycra.
All-powerful and godly.
Lycra.
You claim you're a beast, but you're lying.
Like, rah.
When our mates check our Facebook,
they like, rah.
So bring your short clips of your best bits like a movie trailer. You're like taking candy from a baby, because I'm doing it later. And I'm the opposite of left. Yeah, that's right. You're like taking candy from a baby too, so did it last night.
Mate, you're like an indecisive artist. You don't know where to draw the line.
It was like the thing attached to my car windscreen. I thought it was fine.
No, that was totally inappropriate.
I didn't think you'd notice it.
But that was about as subtle as painting a willy on a voting slip.
I was just boasting wit.
No, that was ropey shit.
Take it easy. I'm just drawing jokes like Matt Groening did. In future, I'll try to be more Lisa and less like Homer is.
All right, it's fine. Our friendship's fine. It's not like you've broken it. See, we forgive each other. We ride the storm like Noah's ship. You ain't got no milk of human kindness.
You're like a broken tip.
Heel turn. Your sex life's like the word of the year. Nothing but selfies. You're trapped in the dark. You're trapped in the dark, like bats in a belfry. Like a McDonald's diet, your work's dumb, it ain't healthy. You've been outclassed and run down like you're under a Bentley.
Now your day's done, like the sky has faded to black. You two piss me off more than paying my tax. This has been a disaster, like a plane when it crashed, and you're like me when I'm drunk. Pain in the ass.
Time, thanks.
It's now decision time. Who's gonna win this battle? If you think Banks at the Gun have done enough to win this battle, please give it up for Banks at the Gun. But if you think the Dead Poets have managed... Don't try and sway the... If you think the Dead Poets have done enough to take this belt home with them tonight, please give it up for the Dead Poets! Listen, guys. You can't buy me. Keep your Monopoly money. The winner of this match is, of course, the Dead Poet! Get off, Banks of the Gun. That brings us to the end of the first half. Please take a 20-minute break. And be back here in 20 minutes time. Take it off. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your ringside seats. We're about to start the second half. Let's get ready to rumble! We're on. Welcome back, Word Wrestler! We're just going to crack straight on with the action. Are you ready for your next bout? I don't think we're... Some people over here ready. A few people over here. Are you ready for your next battle? Okay. It's the All-Star Pro Knockout Match. So please... Welcome to the stage, Emma, Crush Your Bones, John! Event. Please welcome to the stage, Hollie, Megatron, McNish. Let's go for it. Seconds out. And fight!
Do you know what? I'm fucking sick of this, to be honest. This isn't a poem, by the way. I'm meant to get up here wearing spandex and tell all of you lot, in rhyme, how much I hate this amazing woman. And the truth is, I don't hate her. I don't hate her, I love you, Emma. Yeah. What I fucking hate is coming to another poetry gig where the two token females in each half are now put against each other as if we hate each other. Because all the guys in this half are too scared to go against us. So, what I'd like to do for you, I really do, I think you're lovely. What I would like to do is a poem about something that I really do hate. And I don't hate Emma. What I hate is Transformers. Yeah. I hate the fucking Transformers movie. And what I hate most of all about the Transformers movie is being taken to see it on the first date I got to go on with my partner after giving birth to his child and spending the next year and a half breastfeeding every night so that we couldn't go out. And then when we finally got a night out, he took me to see the fucking Transformers movie. And then spent the whole walk home talking about how Megatron is better than Optimus Prime. And for anyone that doesn't know the Transformers movie, Megatron's like the baddie who always loses. Optimus Prime's the goodie. So this is my poem about that, and it's called Hollie Megatron McNish. It's for you, Emma. I really hope you like it. He said, Megatron's the best one. If I was one, it's him. Optimus Prime's all nice and shit, but it's Megatron who really wins. I've listened so many times to this since last week's sodden Transformers hit, and I smile until today I say, Megatron ain't shit. Last year, my hip bones moved another half an inch back together. He said, Hollie, Megatron lives forever. I said, Megatron's not real. If you want to see a real live Transformer, come and have a feel. And I pushed his fingers closer and then right inside my stomach to feel the gap my muscles left from something I now know a bit as birth. And I knew that this would hurt, but I did not know the rest. That there's a hole inside my stomach till the day I'm laid to rest. And no, you're right, I said it's not the same. I did not turn into a car. I turn into a factory, a life support and cooker. As my body started morphing, my insides realigned, my digestive system shifted and completely redesigned itself. No help from the Autobots or the Decepticons. What vitamins I'd got moved from my blood into hers now. The direction of my nutrients redirected into hers. How? I don't know. Everyone sees our stomachs grow. They do not see the wrist. Rib cages cranking up to make more space for baby's legs. Diaphragm moves down. My womb fills up with fluid and a brown line on my skin appeared and no one even drew it. A brown line on my skin from between my legs to boobs. The only line a child can see to lead them to the food. Labour came and went. Something that I won't forget. Baby, now in my arms and my system shifted once again. Digestion redirected to two breasts that grew one night, bigger than a large ripe pair of cantaloupes. Get me a pump, I screamed, genuinely worried that they might explode. My boobs stay warm to heat the food, my nipples make a hole, and every time the baby drinks, the suction makes my womb shrink back, my hips shrink back, my ribs and diaphragm move back, my hair grow back, my back stretch back, and after two more years of doing that, my system shifted back. Nutrients shot back into my own body's blood again. And now I'm almost back to how I was before that seed took life. Complete transformation without one fucking robot fight, but no one makes an action film of this. In fact, all our bodies have to show for it are a few marks on my belly. My hip bones stayed apart a bit and my breasts are pretty saggy. But the saddest thing of all is that I'm told these marks are bad, but they're the only few reminders of this process we all have as the real lifetime Transformers. I'm saying Megatron ain't shit. Compared to female bodies to prepare to grow and feed a kid, and the only thing our body's given for this Optimus of Primes is a pot of fucking stretch mark cream to try to hide the signs. Thank you, I love you, Emma.
Got the bug. The Hollie McNish. You can squish me anytime, Hollie McNish. Well, keeping the theme, this poem is about increasing the peace, because we need to stick together, solidarity, sister, yes. Right, it's about increasing the peace. This is the BBC World Service. How queer they sound to us now, those clipped vowels. Lord Reith, the first general manager of the BBC, was insistent that his listeners should only hear RP, received pronunciation, overseas and here in this nation. Nowadays, of course, we laugh. We're so much more accepting than in the past. We've got James Naugherty on the radio and Lorraine Kelly on the telly.
You'll not hear anyone from Glasgow, but that'd just be silly.
And it's very different now. We've got Glynns and Hughes reading the news. So that's good, isn't it? Well done, us. And we love an Irish accent. We love an Irish scamp. Especially when they're a wee bit camp. But have you noticed? It's never Belfast. Never interviewing. So, Prince William, how are you doing?
And Geordies? Oh, we're doing all right, why aye? Oh, we got and Deck, Cheryl Cole, aye man. Oh, the voice of a little dog in a charity ad. You know just where to can. Lovable, friendly and clownish. But you'd not have us reading the news, like. Angela Merkel has let into a circle the Social Democrats in a coalition. Would you listen? Well, why not? And have you forgot about us Northerners? Nothing says earthy humour more than us. You want an angry factory worker, or a jolly one, or someone to say none of that foreign muck to a volivant. Just call on us. But we don't do intellectual. You won't see a culture show with two of us debating the finer points of Foucault. Oh, and none of us actually say Fook, you know. You've got your anomalies, Brian Cox, but everyone takes piss at what? The way he talks. If you're from the West Midlands, oh, you can be a stand-up comic, feel free. Oh, you can go and appear on a game show. Hello, my name's Barry and I work in IT. But there's never been a Prime Minister called Barry. No one that talks like this. And if we think about it, it seems some things seriously, frightfully amiss. And that brings you round our way. What is this voice good for then? Advertising bakeries or butter? The voice of a cartoon hen? And if you're from Brazil, and for a shizzle, people think you're proper slow, man. Like, can you imagine a nature programme? Oh, here we are, leopard seal. Oh my God, that girt shark's totally got him. No. Well, what about us southerners? We win this game, yeah? Cultural governors. No? Oh, well, that ain't fair. Because if you are from Essex and speak with an estuary elocution, then you ain't nothing but a stereotype, a social climbing aspiring chav, and you, son, won't never read the news each night. Because people don't want to hear about FTSE 100 companies and quantitative easing. Nah, because to their ears, that sound ain't pleasing. But that's because our ears are prejudiced. Our ears are narrow-minded. And our ears need to be opened, because for too long they've been blinded. One of the best things about this little island is the wicked mad jumble of noises. And I can't imagine anything worse. I know, wait a minute. I can't imagine anything worse than if we all homogenised our voices. So let's stop pigeonholing our patois. And let's stop typecasting our tongues. Let's elect to let our dialects digress from their paths and sing new songs. Why should one voice have gravitas and authority? Let all voices ring out with simple, sincere surety. Thank you.
I know there's a lot of love going on in this ring, but unfortunately, Emma, Hollie, we do have to make a decision. We do have to decide who's going to take home this belt. So, are you going to choose Hollie Megatron McNish? Give it up for Hollie Megatron McNish! Pretty good. But are you going to choose Emma Crush Your Bones Jones? Okay, the winner of this, but it's easy for me. I'm cold as, I don't care, someone's going home with this. No, the winner of this belt is, of course, it's a draw. You can take back it home. Give us the rain. Give us the rain. It's finally come to this, guys. It's finally come to this. The final battle of the night. You know, everyone has their favorite, don't they? Everyone has their favorite. I can't quite believe it's come to this. The favorite poetry collective in the whole nation. Full to the brim with my favorite poets. I will cry during this round. It's a fight to the death. It's aisle 16 explodes. Things are never gonna be the same again. So please welcome to the stage, Tim. The Mad Monk, Clare! Next up, we have the champagne conceptualist himself, aka Ross the Cumberband Sutherland! Into the ring, please welcome Luke, the Earl of Essex, Wright!
SD4 used to sell that girl.
And the final member of aisle 16 to take the stage, please welcome Joe, the conditioner, Dunthorne. I'm not sure I'm ready for this. These guys mean a lot to me, but only one of them can go home the winner. We're going straight into the battle. All 16 explodes, fight!
Is it wrong, right, that every creative decision I made regarding my performance tonight stems solely from the single solitary fact that my surname, Sutherland, sounds a bit like the word cummerbund? Is that a sensible way to rule your life? The tuxedo hire alone costs more than my fee for performing tonight. I can't even afford real champagne. This is Asda Carver. I can't afford the real... It's like mouse piss. Have you had this? If I got champagne and I had to hitchhike back to Peterborough. There's nothing wrong with Peterborough. It's convenient. Obviously, like my poetic persona that I've chosen for this evening is someone who's kind of affluent. And it doesn't matter what the truth is, right? It doesn't matter what the truth. Poetry may have a relationship with truth. Wrestling doesn't. Wrestling is all about playing a role and then using that role to hit other people in the face. You three. Yes, you. Don't try to slink off the bear, the girl, the upside down toff. How did you bastards get on my yacht? Let's see your passes. Thought as much. Garçon, escort these here artists off the starboard at once. France is a two-day swim that way. Bonne chance. What's that, lads? What's that down there in the water? You doing your performance poems for me? What's with all the jazz hands and the wild pleading eyes? You're overperforming. That shit leaves me cold. A good poem would be able to internalise all of that thrashing around. The very fact that you feel the need to act it out is a shortcoming of the text. Performance poems don't work underwater. The average performance poem lasts 2.6 minutes. You can hold your breath for, what, 60 seconds max? You do the maths, you do the graph. X-axis, quality of poem, Y-axis, water level. It's like that. It's like that. Like my hand pushing your head under the water until 2.6 minutes have elapsed. Oh, Sir Maurice, how are you? How are the hors d'oeuvres? And the children? I'm looking to raise 30,000. I know you're the man to see about a dog. By dog, I mean money, lots of it. Who's counting? If you need a creative, you should meet my accountant. I'm joking, of course. No, I am quite the craftsman. We should play sometime. I know you've got a great backhand. Oh, them, Sir Maurice, oh, they're no ones, just some blue-faced scribblers who drowned in the drink Shelley did at first. So derivative, don't you think? If poems turn to bubbles, I'll stick to the fizz.
Thanks, Russ. That was timely and whimsical.
Oh, Russ! At just 16, you were my idol. I let your low-slung Essex meek to guide all my decisions with a pen. Such wit. I even copied you a little bit. Each time you wheezed, I sat slack-jawed, enthralled. the chemical poets of Coggeshall. My Brian McFadden to your De Niro. But Ross, old sad Ross, never meet your heroes. You're such a disappointment for a fan. You have the bent physique of someone's gran. At best, your finer features are a mixed bag, wolfing waffle sarnies, reading mixed mag and saying "oh" a lot, listening to hip-hop, making me feel cheap for liking Britpop. Oh, Ross, as sure as Amish men wear hats, I quickly realised you were just a twat. But it didn't matter. No, I didn't care. Because Ross, by then, I'd found Timmy J. Clare. Oh, Timmy J. Clare. Timmy J. Clare. Lewd, rude, and thrusting with oodles of hair. The liver of Winehouse. The conscience of Blair. I was weak from your wickedness, Timmy J. Clare. We cancelled our weekdays with litres of grouse whilst winking at ladies and spooling off Strauss. Such strenuous card games we played round your house. Three in the tournament, you, me, and Faust. But then, Tim, oh, Timmy, oh, Timkins turned nice, all in with the listening, out with the dice. What is this, this empathy, this inclusiveness, tweeting your new agey positive jizz? Oh, me and Mark Griss went to look at some graves. I think I'll write 100 poems today. Oh, I'm so keen on everything. Ross Sutherland, a sonnet. Oh, I like doing rap. I've read a book on it. Timmy J. Clare, so moribund, pleasant man of the people, contemptible peasant. But Tim, you're not so important. You are not so great. I calculated this when I met Joe. Joe is a published novelist. Such a clever man. His poetry is published by Faber. Tim, your poetry is published by me. No wonder you wrote that sad book about not being as good as Joe. Joe only has two emotions, anger and ambition. And yes, I know ambition is not an emotion, but don't tell Joe. His humanity hangs by a thread, as intricate and delicate as one of his much lauded metaphors. I'm just gonna read the next bit off a page to mimic Joe's crap performance style. It's not actually the words, it's just the running order for the night. I bothered to learn it. Okay. Tim, whilst we struggle with our fluctuating weight, two aging colonels at a skate park. Joe's bloody incisors tear through fillets in London swank holes. Look! Look! There goes Joe, scoring on a Shoreditch foosball table, choosing scallops at a market stall, being self-effacing on a panel discussion, his golden hair shining like ideas. It's okay, it seems to say. Joe's here. Shh.
Good evening. I am pleased to take part in this page match project. Let's begin with Luke. Luke, your hair is perfectly contrived to astonish regional theatre audiences. When brought here to our nation's capital, it reminds us only of the reasons we left our small towns behind. And thus fills us with longing for a simpler life. Your trademark suit and vest show you respect your audience, like the old end of the pier comedians. Those end of the pier racist comedians from a bygone age. Regional theatre audiences, Luke, above all, can get behind a man who tries. But here in our nation's capital, your suit is neither skinny enough to be fashionable nor business enough to be a satire on the square mile. And yet we can tell, Luke, that you really mean it. And as such, it makes us uneasy. Filling us with longing for a simpler life. Tim. If I had not been introduced to you by a third party, I would never have approached you. Being, as you are, the kind of person who sits on the floor of train vestibule areas, even when seats are available. But now we are friends, and Tim, I was so gutted when you received template rejection slips from publisher after publisher after publisher. Oh, come on! Oh, come on! You haven't heard what he's gonna say yet. For your fantasy novel about talking dogs. And so it was a great relief that I, upon signing an honestly life-changing two-book deal and selling the film rights, could provide the inspiration for your non-fiction memoir about your struggle with ambition and poor hygiene. I am so glad that I could help you out, because without my extraordinary life to provide your memoir with its most elegant narrative device, I fear publishers would never have taken any notice. Three cheers, then, for the day your memoir won a regional book prize. voted for, it says here, by local primary school children. And all this despite being born without the breath valve that allows most of us to whisper. Now, to Ross. You are funny and clever and never quite achieve the success you deserve, which is charming. I'm told your PhD called, it says here, Future Poetics in the Age of Poor Hygiene, is being written in a new genre, slackademia, that allows you to be difficult without pressure to be profound. It is well known among Isle 16 that Ross and I exist on a lockout. So the other day, our friend Molly texted to say, Ross has just spilt a pot of hot tea on himself. Are you doing anything nice? And I was in the middle of drinking a glass of Amontillado sherry that had been given to me by a stranger who mistook me for someone special. So tonight, I thought it might be fun to just test out the luck axis theory in controlled conditions. So now I've not deliberately not checked my emails all day. So I'm just going to check the emails on my phone and see if I get any good news. And then we'll see if anything happens to Ross. Oh, wow. How are you feeling, Ross? It may not manifest itself as a physical pain. It could be something just like an overwhelming sadness or a hollowness. Or perhaps nothing. I'm losing them. Luke, Tim, Ross, all lovely guys. And in your circumstances, I would be proud of second place. I just get the feeling I would be a good loser. I feel that about myself, though it remains untested. And so it is, with the utmost warmth and best wishes for their passable careers, that I invite them now to practice their facial expressions in preparation for the moment I win.
No. I'd like to start, if I may, with a quotation from His Holiness the Dalai Lama. Let us pray together. Shimmy shimmy ya, shimmy yam, shimmy yay. Give me the mic so I can take it away. Noble brothers, I come here not to fight, but to teach. In the 16 months since I became teetotal and transcended alcohol, I have seen such huge advances in my creative, emotional, and sexual prowess. It is easy to forget what an epic struggle you have just to pull on your trousers. Noble brothers, a parable. Stopping at a monastery during a monsoon, the Buddha met four monks. The first monk had great learning, but was incapable of love. The second monk had fine robes, but an annoying face. The third monk, formerly a beggar from the northern wastes, had great capacity for work, but no one could understand his strange, halting dialect. And the fourth monk was brilliant at poetry. Noble brothers, I suspect the lesson of this parable is lost on you. I do not blame you for your drinking. I would not wish upon you the great suffering of seeing your own faces sober. Joe. When the Guardian's review of your novel, Submarine,
approvingly quoted a line plagiarized from one of my MA short stories. I bore you no malice. Indeed, I was pleased that an offcut from one of my lesser works found a home as the centerpiece of your life's greatest achievement. Like a Fabergé egg gleaming in the eye socket of a child's earnest but ultimately derivative snowman. Remember, dear brother, that fame is as fleeting and transitory as your Welshness. Vanishing for months, only to reappear come regional awards season. Joe, thanks to my incredible spiritual evolution, I have glimpsed your future. You, on your deathbed, clutching the gong for best Welsh Bildungsroman under 35's category, holding it to your elderly chest, surrounded by a miser's cave of Welsh awards, wafters, waskers, and a long list nod for the Wooker Prize. Luke! You didn't get into the poetry game to make friends. Mission accomplished. When you declined your invitation to meet the Queen 2 weeks ago, know that I was not surprised. After all, you spent an entire summer up in Edinburgh, not selling out. Night after principled, financially crippling night. Stay strong, noble brother. As Ovid wrote, so envy feeds on the living, but after death it dies down. Only then can the honour we merit keep fresh our fame and renown. Luke, be comforted. After your death, your poetry no longer handicapped by your divisive face is finally appreciated by clever people. Your pungently satirical masterpiece aren't the Tories' rubbish. Remains as relevant for our children's children's children as it was for us. Ross! Dear Ross, your life is a sweaty puzzle dungeon of small sorrows. Your pockets hemorrhage train tickets, smartphones, and essential medication. Noble brother, I admire your dedication to an existence free from physical possessions as you stagger across train platforms like a zombie dropping limbs. Never has the dictum, live each day as if it's your last, been followed so literally. To add to your misery, with personal attacks about your wild, Sutcliffe-esque eyes would be as futile as flicking a lit match into the sun. Ross, your dogma is trapped inside your karma. Roll down a window. But I bring hope. In a few short years, you are fatally electrocuted during a performance of your critically lauded but poorly attended and understood. It's a knockout style recreation of the Siege of Leningrad. While trying to fix a faulty VGA cable while getting water bombed. Your karmic debt repaid in full, you are reborn as the daughter of Joe Dunthorne into a life of fulsome respiratory health and cheeseboard auteurism. Ladies and gentlemen, Zen teaches us that the true wisdom resides in the small, the closely observed. I'd like to close, if I may, with three haiku. Oh, Ross Sutherland, wheezing like pitchforked bagpipes under pale blossom. On Castle Dunthorne, Welsh snow falls. He counts his groats and disappointments. Luke Wright weeps as he Googles himself. Moonlight strikes his primary chin.
Two, one, two. Hello, I'm back. I'm back. I have to say, that round, it hurt me, guys. It hurt me. Before we come up with a winner, I just have to say, because I won't have a chance afterwards, because I think there might be a fight break out in this very ring. Thank you all much for coming. Thank you for all the acts that come along. We've got merchandise out at the box office if you want to buy any. But it has come to that time that we need to find out who really is the best R16 member. So if you think Tim, the Mad Monk, Claire, deserves to take home this title belt, please give it up! And if you think Ross, the Cumberland Sutherland, deserves to take home this title belt, please give it up! If you think Luke, the Earl of Essex Wright, is your favourite R16 member and deserves to take home this title belt, please give it up now. But if you think Joe, the conditioner, Dunthorne, has struck the most brutal of blows and deserves to take home this title belt, please give it up. I have a tear in my eye for the other three. I won't forgive myself for doing this. But it's a very proud moment to say that the winner of the R16 Explodes Championship belt goes to Luke, the Earl of Essex Wright! Been a pleasure having you. I've been Dan Cockrill. You've been Page Match. Thank you very much.